condenser coil, so that this refrigerant can be condensed yellow colored line, this is the liquid refrigerant discharge. Liquid refrigerant discharge is this yellow colored line coming out of the condenser. It is going into this receiver tank. So this is a refrigerant, liquid refrigerant receiver. After this receiver, we are having this unit. This is the filter dryer unit, which will be used to filter as well as dry the refrigerant. After filter dryer unit, the refrigerant line is coming into this rotameter. So this rotameter will be measuring the flow rate of refrigerant. You can also typically see how refrigerant looks like into this rotameter. After rotameter, this pipeline carrying liquid refrigerant will be going to this solenoid valve. So this is solenoid valve to stop or let refrigerant flow. Then we are having this capillary tube expansion valve. So this is capillary tube expansion valve of this unit one. Then here we are having two connections. So this connection is going to this air conditioning duct, and this connection is going to calorimeter. So in this setup, we have shut down this valve into this air conditioning duct, and we have just opened this valve so that all the refrigerant is going to the calorimeter only. After going into the calorimeter, refrigerant will come again towards the unit 1. In the calorimeter, here we can see there are two pipelines. So this pipeline is coming of liquid refrigerant, insulated one, and this another insulated pipeline which is coming out of the calorimeter. Inside the calorimeter, what we are having is, we are having this copper coils. So it will be carrying liquid refrigerant, and while going into this liquid, this copper coils, it will be producing this refrigerant effect, and water is stored in the calorimeter will get cooled. So there will be a sensible cooling of water, and in turn refrigerant will evaporate. Simultaneously refrigerant will evaporate. So refrigerant will acquire its latent heat of evaporation from sensible cooling of water. So water will be giving away sensible cooling, its sensible heat, and refrigerant will take that heat as its latent heat. Okay. So refrigerant side we have a phase change, and water side we do not have a phase change. So after that, only vapor refrigerant will be there. So that vapor refrigerant will be coming out into this coil. This coil is also insulated because the temperature has dropped down, so that the temperature does not rise before it reaches compressor, because in the compressor, during compression, the pressure and temperature both will rise. Now here we will be following this line. So at this end, this line is coming. So here we can see this line also is joining with this line. So this is from the air conditioning duct. So if liquid vapor refrigerant is going to the air conditioning duct, it will be coming by this line. If it is coming from that calorimeter, it will be coming by this line. So we are having these control valves present over here and at that side also on the top. So this valve has been closed so that no liquid refrigerant goes this way, as we are not supplying this any refrigerant. So it will be going towards this compressor. At this side also we are having a temperature sensor at the suction of compressor, so that its reading can be noted from the panel. Then it will be going into this compressor, and hence the cycle will be completed. Now coming over to the reading part, that what are the readings which are required to be taken. Here we will be reading these temperatures. So here we are having at number 1, discharge temperature unit 1. By switching this selector switch to position 2, we will be moving over to suction temperature of unit 1. Then switching it again, discharge temperature unit 2. Similar to this way, we are having temperature sensors at unit 2 as well. Suction temperature unit 2. Then air outlet temperature of this hygrometric, this air conditioning duct. We are having a temperature sensor at the outlet of for air. Then calorimeter temperature. So that temperature sensor is inside this. So this is calorimetric meter temperature sensor. So it is it would be noting the temperature of the water inside. So by using this selector, we can switch between which sensor reading is displayed on the panel. Now to operate the machine and other parameters, we are required to see other component or part of the panel. So here at the panel, we are having main switch to let power flow into the system. After switching this main switch, we can see that these indicators are indicating what are the voltages and currents available to various parts to which these meters are connected. So basically, this is voltage for everything, and these three are ammeters for three different parts. So this is ammeter for unit 1, this is for unit 2, and this is for ammeter. Similarly, we are having 3 watt meters or energy meters. So this is energy meter for unit 1, this is for 2, this is for heaters. So heaters are only installed in the air conditioning. So 3 energy meter, 3 ammeters, voltmeter is similar, same because voltage is everywhere same. Then these switches, this is switch for solenoid valve unit 1. So at unit 1 we are having this solenoid valve, at unit 2 we are having this solenoid valve. So if we do not switch on this solenoid valve, it will not let refrigerant flow even if compressor is running. So it is just like a gatekeeper. So it has to first allow the refrigerant to flow. So whether or not a not refrigerant is available, if it is not open, refrigerant will not. Then switch for condenser fan motor. So this is for unit 1. We are having a fan at the condenser. So it has to be switched up on after this one. So in the way the switches are mounted on the control panel, in this way only the switches are required to be turned on one by one, not simultaneously. And after experiment finishes, it has to be switched off from the reverse direction. So first this switch will be switched on, then condenser fan motor, then compressor, unit 1, then agitator. In the calorimeter, we are having an agitator as well. So if we switch it on, so here you can see agitator motor runs. So this is switch for agitator. Similarly, these are for unit 2. So in this solenoid for unit 2, calorimeter heater. Heater at the calorimeter. So at calorimeter we are having heating arrangement at them. So there is an immersion coil, immersion rod inside. So that is calorimeter heater. Then switch for heater 1, heater 2, and boiler means this cooker. So these are the switches. So in this experiment, after this we are having these pressure gauges. So two pressure gauges for unit 1, two pressure gauges for unit 2. So these pressure gauges are connected to the compressor, suction and discharge. So this is discharge pressure unit 1, this and suction pressure unit 1. So at this compressor first one, what is the pressures at unit 1 and 2 would be noted down from these two gauges, and these two are similarly for unit 2. So what readings would we get from this setup is, we can get actual energy, electrical energy supplied to agitator, heater, compressor, condenser fan. So all electrical appliances, what are the energy consumptions, can be noted from the energy meter. Then temperatures at various locations, pressure at suction ends, inlet and outlet, and mass flow rate of refrigerant from this calorimeter, this rotameter. So for both units we are having separate two different rotameters. So we can have different mass flow rate of refrigerants flowing through this. In unit 2, we are having this thermostatic expansion valve. In unit 1, we are having capillary heat expansion valve. So, the expansion valve is different. And rest of the things you can see, they are almost the same. Basically, compressor design has changed. Refrigerant is also different. So, in unit 1, we are having R12 refrigerant. In unit 2, we are having R22 refrigerant. So, while using your readings and calculating various parameters, you would be using refrigerant chart for R12 if using unit 1 and R22 if using this unit 2. Is that clear? Now, what are the readings required? Would be known when we know that what is required to be calculated. So, coming out to the calculation part, just come here and see. So, here I have drawn a refrigeration chart for a general refrigerant. So, what you would be getting from this pressure gauges, you will be getting two pressures, suction and discharge pressure. So, on the refrigeration chart, we can draw two horizontal lines on those two pressures. So, on the y-axis, we are having pressure. On x-axis, we are having enthalpy. So, to draw this refrigeration cycle on the refrigeration chart, we require two different pressures. Basically, we require four points of the cycle. So, for locating four points, first, we noted two pressures so that we got two parallel horizontal lines. Then, this top line where it cuts this liquid line, this is where point 3 will be there of the cycle. As you know, point 1 is after evaporator or before the compressor, point 2 is after compressor, before condenser, point 3 is before expansion valve or after condenser, and 4 is before evaporator or after expansion valve. So, point 3 is located where this line cuts this liquid part, liquid line part. So, there we locate point 3. Vertically dropping a perpendicular onto this line, we will be having point 4. Point 1 is on this saturated line. Now, for only point 2 will be left. So, what we will be doing is, we will be assuming that the compressor is isentropic and following a curve parallel to isentropic curves. If none of the curve is passing to point 1, then a parallel curve has to be hand drawn, freehand drawing, and where it cuts this line, we will be locating point 2. So, that is how it will be physically noting these two pressures, and based on two, only just two pressures, you can complete a refrigeration cycle. When this refrigeration cycle has been completed, to calculate the COP, what we require H4 minus H1 upon H3 minus H1. When all four points are already there, then this is not a problem. COP theoretical we can calculate. Coming on to the practical or actual COP, what COP basically is, it is a performance term. So, we require an output energy flow rate and an input energy flow. Means output power by input power will be its actual COP. So, what we are using this refrigeration cooler for is cooling of water. So, for cooling of water, we will be using this equation. So, Qw for water, W, MW, CPW, delta T. So it is MCP delta T, direct simple formula. So M will be mass of water being cooled. So you are required to note down how much mass of water is there inside that calorimeter. CPW is a constant term, you already know. So specific heat of water, how much it is? It is 4.187 kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. Then dTW is temperature before and after, difference between two temperatures. So, before starting the experiment and after completing the experiment, what is the difference in temperature? So, that is delta T. or water. Because temperature is changing, sensible cooling is there. And how much actual power has the setup consumed can be known by the energy. So that is actual energy. So this is actual energy transferred and actual energy used by energy meter. We will be getting actual COP. This is theoretical COP and its thermal efficiency. Thermal efficiency is determined by your theoretical of refrigerant. So how much refrigerant can transfer heat? It can transfer heat by this, we can use this formula M delta H. So mass of refrigerant and delta H is this part, H1R minus H4R. So this is how much heat refrigerant can take away. But it has taken away this, out of this much heat, it draws this much only. So rest of it, it is unable to transfer due to many reasons. So we can get this thermal efficiency of the system. So this was for the part when we are using this as a setup for just the calorimeter. Now if we are using this for air conditioning duct, we are required to refer to this diagram as well. So this is a psychrometric chart at atmospheric pressure. So what we need to do here is we need to know the process. So for psychrometric process, basically depending on what kind of process we are doing in the experiment, its diagram will change. But for one example, say we are just cooling the air. So only one of the unit has been employed to cool the air in this air conditioning duct. In that case, 0.1 will be our initial point, 0.2 will be our final point. So 0.2 location will be at a lower side than 0.1, and on the left hand side from 0.1, because the temperature has to decrease, and if temperature is decreasing somewhat, humidity will also get decreased. If not much, then some amount of humidity will also get decreased. So as we are not having a pure cooling process, we could be having cooling and dehumidification process going on. So how it will be done is, we are having a cooling coil inside the psychrometric duct, and its surface temperature TS will be there. So air from 0.1 will be coming towards surface temperature TS, but will not reach TS, will end in between, because by the time it was required to reach TS, the cooling coil has ended and air has come out of the cooling coil. So it will not reach the cooling coil temperature, it will be a bit more higher temperature than the cooling coil, but less than the initial temperature. So we will get 0.2. Now how to locate this 0.1 and 2 on this chart is by measuring at least two different psychrometric properties on the chart, on the setup. So what our setup has is, it has a provision to measure temperature and relative humidity of air simultaneously. So if we are having DVT driver temperature and RH, we can locate 0.1 as well as 0.2. So before cooling coil and after cooling coil, DVT and RH will be known from the panel. I have just missed one of the panel there. I will be just going to. So 0.1 and 2 can be located. This line, process line, can be drawn, and we can draw a right angle and a triangle in between 0.1 and 2 using this line segment 1 and 2 as hypotenuse of the right angle triangle, so that it has this edge A. So this part 1 to A is a pure latent process. Means here temperature does not change. So from 0.2 A to 1, we are having same DVT. So it is a pure latent process. And this horizontal line segment 2 to A is a pure sensible process. So whether it was heating or cooling. So here in this case, DVT does not change. And here in this case, temperature does not change. So in this part, pure latent heat process. This part, pure sensibly process, and this is overall combined process. So what we can calculate here is this bypass factor. So bypass factor from your CD notes, you can now see that this is the formula. So when all the points are located, all the temperatures could be known from the chart, we can just put the value and calculate the bypass factor. Then what we require is, we require to calculate the sensible heat factor and efficiency. So for sensible heat factor, what we need is, we need sensible heat and latent heat. Sensible heat and total heat. So in this sensible heat and total heat part, both of them can be known from this chart. So this part is the sensible heat part, this part is the latent heat part. So mass of air into delta H for sensible, it is HA minus H2, this is sensible heat part. For latent process, mass of air into delta H, H1 minus HA will give us latent heat part. Total heat is sensible plus latent. And sensible heat factor is sensible heat divided by total heat. So this would be the timing of sensible heat part calculation. Now how to know the mass flow rate of air? For knowing this mass flow rate of air, we are required to use anemometer or velometer. We have an anemometer at the lab. So what it will do is, it will be measuring the air flow rate in terms of flow velocity. So flow velocity in meters per second into cross section area of the duct, which can be measured by using a scale and multiplying the dimension, we will be getting mass flow rate, flow into density also. We will be getting mass flow rate of air. Okay? So this is how mass flow rate of air will be calculated. Now coming over to the last part, which is the efficiency, thermal efficiency of the process, psychometric process. So efficiency is just output by input. So output is cooling of air, input is cooling effect provided by the refrigerant. So cooling of air has been done in this part, mass of air in these state times between 1 and 2, m, hence 1a minus h, 2a. I have specifically mentioned a and r differently because we are having 1 and 2 in both these charts. And on the refrigeration side, mr is mass flow rate of refrigerant, not air. And this is the cooling effect between 1 and 4, this is evaporator line only. So it is h1r minus h4r. Is that clear? Now coming over to the measurement of temperature and humidity of air, just go towards this. So we are having this one more screen here. So at this side, we are having direct measurement of humidity and dry bulb temperature at three locations. So these three locations, temperature and humidity readings are coming directly here. So we are having electronic sensors installed inside. Previously we were having these psychometers, but now these manual psychometers are no longer working. So we have just updated this system by using electronic sensors. So temperature and humidity sensors are working. Is that clear? Now coming over to the measurement of electrical energy, how could we using this energy meter for calculation purposes? Because in the diagram, in this numerical part, calculation part, we require wattage or energy only for the refrigerant part, not for the condenser fan or agitator or heater. But this energy meter is connected all over unit 1. So it includes agitator motor of the calorimeter, it includes condenser fan motor also, along with the solenoid coil. So how to deduct these components from the compressor and use the same meter is by just operating or the additional equipments and not operating compressor and seeing how much energy is needed. Then during experiments, when we are requiring everything, we will be subtracting that constant value from everything. Understood? So this is how we will be proceeding for the energy meter reading. Okay. So this energy meter will be giving you readings in the terms of kilowatt hours. But what we need in that part is we are required to convert into SI. So kilowatt hour is not SI unit for energy. What is SI unit of energy? Energy is joule, power is joule. So I am talking about energy only. So we are required to convert kilowatt hours into joule. So when we are adding a watt per minute, so it already has joule per second. Into hour is there. So you are required to multiply it by converting hour into second and you will get kilowatt.